because you haven't come across it. He obtained his PhD in the field of microbiology and clinical immunology with postdoctoral studies in tumor immunology. His area of expertise includes early detection of cancer signals and markers, immune function disorders, immunotoxicology, chemically induced immune deficiency and autoimmune disease, and immunoassay technology development. He's regarded as an inventor and currently has more than 20 different U.S. patents awarded and pending. He's published 100 articles in peer-reviewed journals and is a member of the International Society for Preventive Oncology, the American Association of Immunologists, the American Association of Advancement Science, Society of Toxicology, California Association for Medical Laboratory Technology. He has testified, this is the most impressive, I think, before the U.S. Senate Committee on Veterans Affairs, providing crucial evidence on the effect of chemical agents on veterans who fought in the Persian Gulf War. His testimony helped secure the passage of legislation that enabled the veterans to receive free medical care for neuroimmunological disorders acquired during service in the Persian Gulf. Thank you, Dr. Khrushchev.
Thank you. Mark has been a great host. I appreciate for picking me up and excellent dinner we had together. Actually, recently you heard that the soldiers who had Gulf War syndrome, they developed also ALS. It was in the news.
ALS.
Yeah. Majority, yes. More in comparison to those who did not serve in the Gulf War, if they took like 10,000 and then 10,000 who served in the Gulf War, there are threefold more ALS among those who serve in the Gulf War. So therefore, the neuroimmunological disorder I described 10 years ago was something then we could see that. So therefore, now he's ending up with ALS or other neurological disorders. I would like to make also comments about the transplantation of fetal cells that I know that in many universities, they tried fetal cells for Parkinson's disease. You know, the substantia nigra, which is destroyed almost, they injected that in the brain area without any success. I believe even President Reagan was, he was one of those who they tried it on him, but no success at all because they said those cells, the immune system cells, attacking those and destroyed them within a few hours and that's it. But in this case, I don't know what's the mechanism of action, as you said, that when you take young cells and old, maybe there are some transfer factors, there are some growth factors secreted from those, and so we have to learn more about this. Finally, I read really one of the most fascinating article last week in Science about copper. Two different university centers were funded a grant to study relationship between fat in the diet and Alzheimer's disease. And the model was rabbits. So, one University of Phoenix and the other one on the East Coast, they had exactly the same procedure and added some fat to the diet, and they were looking for Alzheimer's disease. One group, high percentage of rabbits, after a few months being on that diet, developed Alzheimer's. The second group did not develop Alzheimer's. And they were amazed, how come? If only one lab was doing that, either they were getting negative results, the other lab positive results. So it was just by chance they did two different laboratories. So they tried to find what was the problem. They figured out the water was the answer. The water, the drinking water they were giving to the rabbit was the answer. Okay? One of them were giving tap water to the rabbits. The other one, they had distilled water they were giving to the rabbits. The group who gave distilled water to the rabbits, no Alzheimer's. The group who gave them tap water developed Alzheimer's. When they analyzed, and this is in Science, 2 weeks ago, if you want a copy, I have it. Okay, so when they analyzed, copper was the highest concentration in the tap water, and therefore the combination of copper, even at the concentration we have it in the tap water, along with high fat diet causing Alzheimer's in animal models, in rabbits. Then they really took the distilled water and added copper to it plus fat diet. The same laboratory who did not develop the disease, they did develop. Okay. So therefore, really the relationship, combination of chemicals in our environment plus fat in the diet together and neurological disorders. That was just some kind of a good introduction.
Do you know if the tap water had chlorine and fluoride in it?
Well, they have a lot of things, but mainly they put their finger on copper, and the copper was reproducible.
And then subsequently they added only copper, right?
Yes. Yes. Okay, so really we have to be careful with everything. Too much, I'm talking at the level of tap water. Okay. So now, as far as my presentation to you guys, I have 4 publications in scientific journals about the effects of vitamin C and enhancement of immune function. That's the end part of my presentation. So I'll get to that. Just be patient with me. I would like to start with this slide, which is a kind of a summary of probably 30 years of working in a clinical laboratory and doing research. What I believe, most complex diseases, in addition to genes, which are important, the environmental factors such as viruses and toxic chemicals play a significant role in their development. I just gave you an example of Alzheimer's. So those two, either infectious agents or toxic chemicals, they enter into the body, they affect our system, our functional system. Whether it's at the cellular level or DNA, they bind to the DNA, they cause DNA damage, and if this road will continue this way, the end result of that will be a disease. In this particular case, we are talking about cancer. However, the body is victorious, the body is beautiful, we have many, many mechanisms of protection in place. So those mechanisms of protections are even more important than the markers of damage. And those are protecting us, correcting all those damages occurred due to toxic environmental chemicals and infectious agents. One of them is cytochrome P450 enzyme, overall, the liver enzymes which are metabolizing the toxic chemicals. But unfortunately, during the process, sometimes we metabolize them to chemicals, metabolites which are more carcinogenic, which more causing cancer. The next one you can see, if we have low levels of antioxidant, and that's really the issue of vitamin C. If we have low levels of antioxidants, also we are letting this road continue towards the right. And next to that is DNA repair enzymes. When DNA is damaged, we have a set of enzymes which are correcting the damaged DNA and therefore preventing a disease. And finally, the beautiful cells called natural killer cell activity, which that's the topic of my research with vitamin C. If we can enhance those cells to kill the first few tumor cells in our system, we are going to prevent future cancer development. Now, today I had TV program, I just may simplify that to the audience this way, saying that really disease or cancer is similar to a road. Let's take Highway 101. And throughout the years when the cars are driving and in some states, for example, there is snow and rain and all of that, the road get damaged. And if in damaged road, cars which are driving, some of them may run into accidents, and some of those accidents, people may die. However, so that's really the way, this way, that's the road. But we have also engineers and workers coming, fixing the road for us. Depends on the competition between these two. If we have only few workers, which they don't have enough time, to correct or fix the damaged road, then we'll have accidents. If they will be faster than whatever occurs in the road, then they'll correct the damage before any accidents to occur. So really remember this, that's really the analogy exactly to what's happening in our system. But those will be in trouble, really. The roads will be the most dangerous if you have the traffic, you have the snow, you have the rain, you have all these things which are damaging the road, but you don't have any engineers and no workers to fix the road. And definitely that's the end result of that will be, you know, severe accidents, and finally many people will die in that road. And that's really what's happening in relation to many diseases in our system, especially cancer. So I have a booklet with me over there, which is the back of this, is I call that cancer volcano. Whatever you see up there as a cancer volcano started 10 to 20 years before with oxidative stress. So therefore, at every stage of development, we can stop and prevent the progress of the disease or the progress of this reaction towards the volcano. So that's the next message. What are the causes of cancer? Any factors inducing cell division, including growth factors, like, you know, like growth hormone. That's why if something, you know, if you use too much of it, it may cause prostate cancer or breast cancer. Any factors inducing DNA damage, and any factors causing alteration of the immune function. These are the three major factors. Now, it's hard to read, but I will come back to this, but there is a significant amount of information in here taken from an article which I have only one copy or two copies with me from a journal which you guys do not read. It's a part of the Society of Toxicology called Toxicological Sciences. But in that special issue, they summarized all animal models of cancer and how we can prevent them by nutrition. And in that one, in the same article, there's this table. What are the causes of cancer? If we look at some of these percentages, all the way down there, it says unknown. The unknowns, it's between 3 to 25%. But they are telling us today we don't know about 25% of the cancers, what is causing them. You can have the best diet, exercise, the best environment, but still you may get cancer. Maybe we'll learn about that 25%, up to 25% in the future, but right now we don't know. So let's talk about the other 75%. The other 75% that's telling us that 30 to 35% are diet related. So if you have bad diet or good diet, you can prevent 35% of the cancer. Occupational exposure, 5 to 7%. Which I believe it's much more than that. That's very conservative. And then smoking and drinking, maybe this is exaggerated, but again, this is based on many, many research articles, and probably this is from National Cancer Institutes. 33 to 40%. So if you add up those together, you have about 75% of, almost 70% of the cancer, which therefore they are preventable. Where are the genes? Okay. The genes are right in here. Okay, genetics, right here. Only 2 to 3%. But I believe that number should be around 5%. So only 5% of cancer so far we know they are related to genetic makeup. Maybe we'll learn more in the future, but right now they are telling us at least the most conservative, 50% of cancers are preventable. The most conservative. From 50 to 75% of cancers are preventable if we pay attention to our lifestyle. That's really the message of this article. So how can we use this information and prevent cancer by looking at biomarkers? Biomarkers are manifestation or physiological manifestations are changes that may occur and the pathway to disease. And again, the analogy is really based on the next slide, where in the cardiovascular disease, many people, they judge the disease based on lipids. That's really, you know. But us, we are looking at many, many more factors, many other factors. So lipids are important, I'm not denying that. But again, we have markers of oxidative stress. We have markers of inflammation. We have markers of coagulation. And we have the infectious agents. So all these together are biomarkers for detection of cardiovascular disease. The same thing, we can develop biomarkers for early detection of cancer. And therefore, using that kind of information, we'll be able to prevent many types of cancer. One of those biomarkers is shown in this slide. It's called apoptosis, or programmed cell death. And if you look at the structure of a cell right there, the green and with all those beads around it, that's actually the nucleus and the cell membrane. When the cell is exposed to oxidative stress, many chemicals, and free oxygen radicals, the results of oxidative stress will be damage to the DNA, the DNA break, or mitochondrial damage, you know, the factory making the energy in the cells, or membrane damage. So we can have membrane damage, which is right here, phosphatidylcholine and phosphatidylserine. We can have mitochondrial damage, and then you can have DNA damage. So, all these three can happen due to exposure to toxic chemicals. And then the cells will go through programmed cell death. I'm talking about, for example, our white blood cells in this case. So then we have a cell. Each cell has a cell cycle. There are four phases in each cell. We would like to have one of the last phases of cell cycle is mitosis, meaning cell division. In the body, we would like to have homeostasis between apoptosis, meaning cell death, versus mitosis, which is right here. Apoptosis versus mitosis, they have to be equal to keep homeostasis in our system. If we have up there more mitosis, less apoptosis, that will be tissue growth, and results of that will be cancer. The other disease is autoimmune disease. If certain type of cells attacking our nerve cells, in the case of multiple sclerosis, they will not go through programmed cell death or apoptosis, those cells will attack the brain cells, and then the result will be development of multiple sclerosis. So, therefore, we need all some cells which are, you know, to go through this program. So therefore, autoimmunity and cancer are the results of more mitosis. If we have opposite to that right here, more apoptosis, less mitosis, that's meaning cell, you know, waste of cells, atrophy. Patient with chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia will have that. And if you pay attention to some patients who have exposure to toxic chemicals, or even they have viral infection, they are tired. Many of their white blood cells, they go through programmed cell death, because the chemicals inducing the cells, damage cells, to go through programmed cell death, because the body doesn't like damaged cells. That's exactly what happens to HIV infected cells, the natural killer cells, either attacking them or the cell itself goes through programmed cell death or self-killing. That's the mechanism of a body to get rid of any damaged cells or infected cells. So therefore, this is one of the best markers of oxidative stress, to measure oxidative stress in our system, whether or not we have a balanced diet or not. You do a test called apoptosis. similar to tests, we do natural killer selectivity. In this case, we take a tube of blood in yellow top tube. We separate the cells. We culture them for 24 hours in the tissue culture facility. Then we take those cells and measure the degree of DNA damage by flow cytometry, which is a classical method. There are reagents available that you can stain damaged DNA, or you can stain damaged membrane, you can stain damaged mitochondria. Based on that, you'll get the percent of the cells which are going through this program. Normally, a healthy individual with good balanced diet, with good antioxidant in the system, only between 0 maximum to 5% of your cells, white blood cells, should go through programmed cell death or apoptosis. But if you have much higher than that, meaning you have significant amount of oxidative stress, you will be one of the candidates after taking vitamin C. I would like to see what will happen to your white blood cells. Whether you increase apoptosis of your white blood cells, you are decreasing apoptosis. So I'm sorry, I would like to remember your name. Okay, so that's first one experiment we would like to do on your blood. I'll come back again to that. So really that's because if, for example, we take too much vitamin C, and that vitamin C is becoming oxidant, will damage the membrane of the cells, maybe will damage the DNA of the cells, and then we'll detect more apoptosis. If it's protective, we'll detect less apoptosis. So that's one of the very elegant experiments to perform on individuals who are taking high doses of vitamin C. Now again, to homeostasis and balance, okay? And in a very really simplistic approach, here the balance, proto-oncogenes are the genes which are promoting cell growth and differentiation. The tumor suppressor genes are preventing cell division. Okay, so again, like in the car, we have the accelerator and we have the brake, and that's, we need to have a balance between these two. So if chemicals will activate, or even some infectious agents will activate the proto-oncogenes, then our tumor suppressor genes will not function. By the way, we have not only one level of tumor suppressor genes, we have four different levels of tumor suppressor genes. That's why it's very difficult to induce tumor or cancer, or to develop cancer, because we have four levels of tumor suppressor genes. If the first level of genes will not work, always there is a second phase, and the third phase, and the fourth phase. If all four will fail, then the cell will go to cell division right in here, and one cell becomes 2 and 4 and 8, 16, and so forth. So, if activation of metastasis genes are in place, and we have inactivation of all tumor suppressor genes, the results of that will be cancer. And taking antioxidants, definitely we can prevent some of these reactions. Natural killer cells is one of my favorite cells, because between 1981 and 1985, after I did my postdoctoral studies at UCLA, I did measure the effects of toxic carcinogenic chemicals on the immune system. The experiments which we did perform were injecting mice of different strains with carcinogenic chemicals. Then from the first day up to 3 months, we were measuring the natural killer cell activity in these mice. In mice which chemicals knocked out the activity of natural killer cells, they developed cancer. If natural killer cell activity was in place in specific strain, that animal did not develop cancer. So from that we learned, that was almost 20 years ago, we learned that natural killer cells are first line of defense, protecting us against cancer. Secondly, Natural killer cells are involved in destruction of viral infected cells, such as CD4 cells infected with HIV, or some cells infected with hepatitis B or hepatitis C. Yes, please.
What was the factor that knocked out the cell? What was it? How did it do that?
Okay. Exactly how, we don't know exactly the mechanism of action, but we know the chemicals which we use was methylcholantrin, which is the carcinogenic chemicals found in the air pollution, mm-hmm. or benzanthracene, or benzyapyrene. These are highly carcinogenic chemicals. They get metabolized in the body to epoxides, which are even 10 times more carcinogenic than the parent compounds. So these epoxides bind to DNA and cause DNA damage, but from other hand also change levels of the cytokines and many factors involved in natural killer cells when the body doesn't have enough cytokines, such as TNF-alpha, IL-2, interferon gamma, which are important for natural killer cells to attack tumor cells and kill the tumor cells. So that's really indirectly what we never could measure directly exactly what happened.
So how would you intercept the chemical to neutralize it so it doesn't get to the cellular structure?
When you are exposed to it?
Yeah, I mean,
you can.
If you're exposed to it, how would you neutralize that?
You can.
Really?
It goes in your system and stays there for many years. Because it binds, the epoxide binds to your cells and causing cell mutation.
Do we know why it binds?
Because of the structure of the chemical is such a way. Let me give you a simple example, okay? If you take formaldehyde, you know what's formaldehyde? It's a very small molecule, HCHO. And you just open a bottle of formaldehyde and smell formaldehyde. You'll feel that formaldehyde for hours in this area of your system. What happened? Why do you smell it 2 hours later? The bottle is gone. You smell a little bit of formaldehyde. The formaldehyde molecules penetrated your tissue and bound to it covalently and stayed in there. And that's why people working for years with formaldehyde, they developed nasopharyngeal cancer. So that's a very simple way of explaining how chemicals can bind to our tissue and cause cancer. Yeah, the pathologists, definitely. The pathologists, they have more cancer of nasopharyngeal.
Are NK cells a certain kind of white cell?
Yes, okay. Yes. They're white blood cells. Yeah. Right. They're called large granular lymphocytes. Large granular lymphocytes. I'm sorry, I don't have a picture of that to show you, but they have small bullet-like material inside the cell, which they release from NK cell. It goes into the membrane of a tumor cell, exactly like a missile, and making a hole in the membrane of a tumor cell and destroys the tumor cell. Because it has many enzymes, granzyme and so forth. It's the analogy of a missile, it's really great. Yes, Mark?
You're on natural killer cells. You made the point that they get suppressed. But does that mean that if you take a supplement of some kind that boosts natural killer cell activity, that you're counteracting that?
Yes, it's an excellent question. There are many, many publications also. If you infect an animal, you give some infectious agents, or you give the toxic chemicals to the animal, from one hand. From other hand, give them antioxidants. You can prevent cancer this way. Yes, absolutely. You can prevent development of infectious diseases by giving antioxidant. You prevent the growth of bacteria or viruses in the system. Definitely. Experimentally has been done.
There are specifically things that are not antioxidants but that stimulate NK cell activity.
Absolutely. Such as, let me give you the best example. If you take thymic hormones, one of the best biological response modifiers, That's a, you know, a name that's given to these factors, which are enhancing natural killer cells and the immune system, is in times. Many years ago, it was purified, and small quantities can enhance natural killer cell activity and different cytokines. The other one is lentinin from shiitake and maitake mushroom. It was also purified and synthesized, which you can, you know, they have been used on cancer patients. It has been used on cancer patients to prevent cancer using this type of molecules called biological response modifiers, definitely have been in use. So let's look at some of the natural killer cells. First of all, let's explain to you how do we do measure natural killer cell activity. Okay. In our laboratory, we have tumor cell lines, leukemia cell lines, and other type of cell lines. We grow them in culture. Every day, we have two technicians specially come to the laboratory. They take these tumor cells and label them with benign radioactive material called chromium-51. So now these tumor cells, their membrane is labeled with this radioactive material called chromium-51. When you guys send blood sample, a yellow top tube, which is 10 ml blood in a yellow cap tube, we separate the white blood cells by a method which is a kind of sugar for high density. We layer it on top of that called FICOL HIPEC, which is a sugar. Then we centrifuge the blood. The red blood cells goes all the way down because their density is heavy. The white blood cell stays somewhere in the middle. So with a pipette we go and we take that buffy coat of the white blood cells, wash it from the sugar, and then we count them. So now we have tumor cells labeled with chromium-51. We have the white blood cells of the patient. Then we, after counting, we mix these two together with different proportions. So the proportion is like this, that 50 white blood cells, one tumor cells, 25, one, 12 white blood cells, one tumor cell, and 6 white blood cells, one tumor cell. It's exactly not one, but you know, maybe 100,000 and so forth. Okay? But with that kind of proportion. Then we ask the question, if you have 50 soldiers against one enemy versus 6 soldiers against one enemy, which one of them should kill the enemy faster? Obviously, the 50 soldiers, with all of them with ammunition, correct? But what if you have 50 soldiers against one enemy without ammunition, they will not be able to kill even one enemy. But if you have 6 soldiers with ammunition, they'll be able to kill better. So therefore, you will see some of these examples what I mean by. Okay, so we did this experiment when I was doing the Gulf War syndrome studies. This is what we did. In the experiments you do, you have to have the controls. Without control, that experiment is not an experiment. So I agreed in 1992 to do this study, but my condition was give me also control soldiers. So we got 50 control soldiers did not go to Gulf War, and 50 who did go to Gulf War. So what happened that if you look at soldiers' control versus civilian controls, that's you and I, you will see the soldiers, they have twice natural killer cell activity than us. Okay, so to begin with, if I would have compared the soldiers, 6 soldiers, to civilian soldiers, they would have had the same level. So anyway, that's the reason I'm putting the soldiers control in here, because when we did the 6 soldiers, they were about this much also. Half of the, so they were exactly almost like the healthy civilians. So therefore, that's one thing. So let's get just to the civilians right in here. 41 plus minus 19 lytic units, meaning the unit with capability of killing the tumor cells. So let's go back to the experiments. Okay, so we mix them together, right? We do that ratio. We keep them for 4 hours in the incubator. Then we take and centrifuge. If the lymphocyte kill the tumor cells, the tumor cell bursts and releases the chromium. The more chromium released from the membrane, the more killing of the tumor cells. So we measure the amount of chromium in the cell, in the supernatant, in the liquid after centrifugation. In a special computer program, we get our lytic units. So the higher the lytic units, the better the killing of the tumor cells. The lower the lytic units, the worse the killing of the tumor cells. And that's what we got. Mechanism of chemotherapy.
Repeat that last sentence again.
If you take a patient with cancer, you know, at the early stage of cancer, the natural killer cell activity is very high because the body is fighting. The body is fighting. If you put that patient on chemotherapy, next day, the NK cell activity goes to zero. Because chemotherapy destroys the healthy cells and destroys the cancer cells. Apoptosis, you remember? That's exactly what chemotherapy does. It destroys the DNA, the membrane, as well as the mitochondria, and the cell burst. Goes to program cell death or apoptosis.
So what happens when it doesn't kill all the cancer cells when you have chemo? Then what's the case?
What happens when, okay.
Yeah,
that's when some cells get smarter, cancer cells get smarter. Chemotherapy doesn't work on them, but the white blood cells get destroyed and the cancer cells grow
right. Crazy.
Thank you for asking that. Yes. So that's really but then you have to wait until, you know, the body white blood cell will go again up, and then you give another chemotherapy. Please.
Is the alcohol intoxication group, is that, are these chronic alcoholics?
Chronic alcoholic, absolutely. They have
from a hangover.
No.
Okay.
To the level of liver dysfunction.
Okay.
That's really the thank you.
Doctor, did you say earlier that thymic protein enhances
natural killer cell activity?
That's Patrick Beardsley's.
No, I am sorry. Let me clarify, because, you know,
okay.
When I said thymic hormones, that original work by Dr. Goldstein from George Washington University, Georgetown or George, yeah, one of those. And also a group in Italy and a group in Israel, Weizmann Institute, about 25 to 30 years ago, they purified from the thymus hormone-like material, which that one, they tried it in animals as well as in human to enhance natural killer cell activity, and it was tried even in AIDS patients. That's different from thymic protein A. In fact, I have a publication with the group in relation to enhancement of natural killer cells and the use of thymic protein A, but this is different from that. Also, to show you, some companies who really, sometimes they advertise that they have extract of thymuses. When I went to lecture by Dr. Goldstein many years ago, he was giving example that if you want 1 milligram of pure thymic hormone, you need to take more than thymuses from 200 cows in order to purify 1 milligram of thymic hormone. So when some of these companies come and tell you that they have capsules with thymic hormones, that's really almost nothing.
How about the Atrium product that's called thymus extract that's frozen?
I just gave you the example, really.
That's
based on what I heard from the expert in the country, that, you know, you have to have about 100 cows in order to get 1 milligram of pure hormone. Because, you know, that thymic hormone is very low concentration, but it's extremely efficient. You need picograms in order to, you know, to have activities. You don't even have microgram levels. Yes?
I'd like to ask you about a case that happened a few years ago. In a duplex building, the woman downstairs and the woman upstairs, totally unrelated, both contracted liver cancer. They just happened to live in the same building, not related. And I wondered if you were presenting...
Something in the building.
Well
they got together and drank every night together, maybe.
Huh?
Water in the building or molds in the building? Mycotoxin. One of these two.
Okay, thank you.
Well, they got together and drank every Friday, every afternoon and every morning and every night.
Another question.
Yeah.
What was the implication for the thymic protein A?
The implication was that we found significant percentage enhancement of natural killer cell activity. But the area was they tried patient with chronic fatigue syndrome. In patient with chronic fatigue syndrome, they have certain lymphocytes with specific markers are abnormal in patient with chronic fatigue. Out of three markers, which we they are abnormal in patient with chronic fatigue, one of them was returned to normal by using thymic protein. Question over there?
Yes. Are there any oral thymus preparations that are any good that you've found so far?
I don't know. Again, and I'm like yourself here. I'm not really promoting any product. So therefore, here you can see the cancer patients who need the most the cells to fight, they don't have them, unfortunately, when they need them. And therefore, it's our role, the clinician's role, to enhance natural killer cell activity as much as possible. If you want really a single test to follow a patient's treatment, how your patient is doing, I don't want you to put you in a $1,000 expense. It's only $150 you do. Natural killer cell count and activity. That's enough. You don't need any other tests as far as immune function.
I've never had an MD in my life that was talking about NK and enhancing it or anything like that. I've never had an MD say that in my entire life.
Wrong MD.
I'm sorry.
I've never had a doctor talking about NK, natural killer
thank
cells.
Thank you. Okay.
Talk a lot about other stuff.
Let me. Okay. I don't expect your doctor to talk to you about, because I did my postdoc at UCLA. I learned all these methodologies I'm explaining to you at UCLA, Department of Immunology. Okay. This is the immunology building. This is the oncology building. They are connected. But these two, they don't talk. Up to today, the oncologists in the building, they do not use natural killer cell activity on their patients. Which is really this is really, if something I can't understand it.
Heresy. It's heresy.
Yeah.
That's why they won't do it.
And this is mainstream, natural killer cell activity, it's mainstream of medicine. It's not alternative medicine. When I started doing natural killer cell activity 15 years ago, the only doctors who started, paying attention were alternative medicine doctors. That's why we are promoting it with alternative medicine.
See, but not all the oncologists can tell you a great deal about radiation and about chemotherapy.
They don't want to know about NK cell activity because it'd be zero in their chemo patients, right? So that wouldn't look
good. But really, if you want to see prognosis of your patient, you have to do natural killer cells.
Kind of suggests that you shouldn't do
chemo.
There are
thousands of articles in scientific literature who really recommend follow-up of the patients or with natural killer cell activity, but until you get to the practice of medicine, I will not be in this world. Unfortunately. Okay, so here example. That, remember I told you that we take...
It takes like 3 days to bring back the white blood cells after chemotherapy.
Right.
3 days.
Well,
not just all the way up.
But are those white blood cells as good, as strong as it should be?
In my experience, it takes about 3 weeks.
3 weeks?
Until the cells will... return to their functionality.
Sure. 3 weeks. But
yes. Not 3 days.
They already put in another chemo, so...
That's why they wait and then they put another chemo. The problem is this, that really, I heard the experts that those which I believe in them, they say antioxidants before chemotherapy, during chemotherapy, and after chemotherapy. But oncologists say no antioxidants before chemotherapy, during chemotherapy. When you finish your chemotherapy and you are dead, then you can use antioxidants.
Is there any logic to that? I mean, did they use it?
That's really what the logic. The logic is, you remember apoptosis? They say if the goal of chemotherapy is to push cells to go through apoptosis, you give vitamin C, you prevent apoptosis. You'll see in my research, yes, they're absolutely correct about inhibition of apoptosis, meaning you make the cells to stay in your body longer, to become healthy. That is true with healthy cells, not with cancer cells. They mix the tumor cells, cancer cells, with healthy cells. Antioxidants prevent apoptosis of healthy cells, induce apoptosis of tumor cells.
Wow.
And that's, and I have at least, Dr. Prasad did many research. I don't know if some of you know him. Have you, yeah, you can invite him one day.
Yeah, he's,
sure. Does the cancer?
He's from Texas, or is he? What's his first name?
I think he gave a lecture at ACAM.
Yes.
Prasad.
Yes.
Does a cancer cell get to be like all viruses, that they become educated? I mean, you start dealing with chemotherapy.
Yes.
The cancer
resistant, yes.
They educate themselves and they turn evil.
Absolutely. Yes. Now let's go back to this, and I need to share with you my research also, right? Now this is a curve. You remember the 50-1, 25-1. If I get a curve like this, okay, this is where is 6-1, 12, 25-1, and 50-1. You see more soldiers, more killing. Less soldiers, less killing of the tumor cell. That's the way it should be. That's a healthy individual with a good natural killer cell. But look at this one. See this one right here? Cancer patient after chemotherapy. Zero NK cell activity. I have hundreds and thousands of examples like, because I work with many doctors who see cancer patients, and we do their NK cell activity.
I guess one thing that was missing from the introduction is that you run a lab, right?
Yes.
Ah.
I'm sorry, I'll get to that in the
symbols in the lower left corner of all the slides.
Ah, yeah. Immunoscience.
Let me go back and just very short, thank you so much. That I, as you said, I did my PhD in the field of microbiology immunology, postdoc at UCLA in the field of tumor immunology. Then in 1988, I decided to keep the honor of UCLA, just do research, whatever, with my colleagues without getting any salary from them, to be independent and start a laboratory in Beverly Hills where I'll have my own freedom. Now we have our own building, about 10,000 square feet, 25 people working for us. And I do really enjoy research and development and working with many companies. Sometimes they try to examine their product. There are many, many claims out there, but they don't have real experiments behind it. They come to me sometimes and we work together. In fact, we are in the process of working with Genentech on one of the multiple sclerosis project, which is in the process of negotiation. So we are really working also with companies who are interested to test their product for enhancement of the immune function.
You know, my understanding is that the human body is like a chemistry experiment. In your body, you're always trying to get the balance correct. If you do something like chemotherapy, you wipe out the chemistry lab. It's over with. You can't balance that. What you're trying to really do, no matter what the illness is, you're trying to get the chemistry of that particular individual balanced, homeostasis.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
Would you like us to hold some questions until the end?
If it's possible.
Okay. Let's do that.
Yes. Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, now, let's give credit to another lab before us. I know Dr. Guilford knew the laboratory, specialty lab. I think they were the first one who started natural killer cell activity. And I know the owner, which now he's out. He sold the company to, but I give him a lot of credit, who had a vision to start immunology laboratory almost 25 years ago. And today is one of the biggest laboratories in the field. And we were the second one. We started immune evaluations and natural killer cell activity because of my specialty and love to the field of immunology. So since then, really, I have done many, many testings. And the method I just described to you is the most sensitive. There are some more labs, they started doing natural killer cell activity. They are not using chromium 51 because to have a license in the state of California to handle radioactive material, believe me, it's not easy. Okay, because they come and inspect you from the commission, whether radioactive commission, whatever you call it. So those who try to have a shortcut, they do the method by colorimetric. Colorimetric assay is 10 times less sensitive than chromium 51. This is the gold standard. So therefore, we continue that. So about a few years ago, I came with this following question. How do you know that a person is having 20% natural killer cell, another one having 50% natural killer cell? How do you know really which one of them, per cell, per number of natural killer cells, which one of them they're, you know, having a better activity? So I came with the idea that we have to take the activity and count the soldiers, divide them one with another. That's what you get, the NK cell activity per cell. So now, in addition to doing the lytic units of NK cell, we express it by NK activity per cell. Let me give you another example. If you have a cancer patient with NK cell activity 100, and he has 100 NK cells, so the activity per cell is 1, right? Now you hit that person with chemotherapy, you kill some cells, and then the NK activity also goes down. In this case, if I don't count the number of cells and just give you 0 NK cell, that's wrong. But if I'll give you in the same patient NK cell activity per cell, will not change actually after chemotherapy, almost, right? Because many cells died, those who few left, they have still some activities, and therefore you divide those by these few cells, still you get similar activity per cell. But it dropped from 100 to 2 or 5. So therefore it's very important to express the activity also per cell. And that's why we came here. If you look at NK cell activity lytic units, we have several examples. If we have percent NK cell 16, and that's really should be between 5 to 20% natural killer cell percentage of the white blood cells, actually. That's if you have high NK cell activity, a normal NK cell number, probability of cancer is low. If you have the numbers goes high, 24, the activity is high, probability of cancer is moderate. Why? Because this is a flag. Why suddenly the body called troops to fight? Then the next one, it goes to 39%. This is a real patient. And 39%, and suddenly the activity is very high also. When you have very high NK cell activity, and you have very high NK numbers, even if you don't have a tumor, detectable tumor in the system, you really have to be careful and look for it. Meaning there is some tumor somewhere in the body that it's not detectable yet, but in the future will be detectable. So that's really where you have to pay attention. That's why we have to count the numbers and activity of the natural killer cells. And finally, when you have very, the numbers are low, the activity are very low, then that's really the stage of the last stage of cancer.
But how do you know that the probability is very high in that person?
How do we know?
Track those people and find out that they actually did end up having cancer?
Yes. So now we, in relation to, so that was about cells, we measure which can fight cancer. How can we improve the ability of the body to fight and protect us against cancer? And antioxidant protection, antioxidants can protect us against lipid peroxidation, can protect us against DNA adduct. DNA adducts meaning chemical molecules binding to our DNA causing cell mutation or DNA damage. Okay, the next one is DNA damage. Can inhibit cell division, meaning prevents cancer. Induction of apoptosis of cancer cells, but inhibition of apoptosis of normal cells. And finally, antioxidants improve function of the immune system because enhancement of natural killer cell activity, T cell function, B cell function, and macrophage function. Now, when we measure levels of antioxidants, there are many, many articles in scientific literature. They show inverse relationship between plasma levels of antioxidants and cancer. The higher the levels of antioxidants in plasma or in blood, the better you are protected against cancer. Very well established. However, there are some subpopulation of patients who have high levels of plasma antioxidants who cannot absorb intracellularly. And therefore, you have to pay attention to that subgroup. And some of those are cancer patients. You give them a lot of antioxidants, but due to some dysfunctionality at cellular level, they cannot absorb the cells. And therefore, when you measure antioxidant levels, you have to measure both plasma levels and intracellular levels.
Question?
Can you go back to the slide while I have a question?
In the Finnish study on beta carotene, what interpretation did you have of that, where the more antioxidants you took, the more cancer you got?
Well, first of all, that was, I believe, in smokers.
Smokers,
yes, that's one. Secondly, I can give you my opinion about vitamin C because I did studies with vitamin C. But I'll get to that. But again, with vitamin A, we have to be careful not to go over the limit also. That's first of all one study, and was in smokers, I don't know. Here today we heard about combination of copper with fat and Alzheimer's. You don't know, in smokers versus non-smokers, this may be different mechanism, but still in smokers significant, you are right.
There was a second study in the United States called CARET, C-A-R-E-T, that showed the same result.
What was the level?
I don't know the level.
It was 25,000 units, I believe.
Yeah,
they were saying was that the beta carotene stopped the oxidation of the apoptosis.
I don't have any really opinion about that right now. So let's continue. So I said that we need to measure both plasma and intracellular levels of antioxidants. And this is my US patent, how to measure intracellular cellular levels of antioxidants, both fat-soluble and water-soluble vitamins. Exactly the same thing I explained about natural killer cells. You take white blood cells and you break them and you measure the content within the cells. And it's possible because the technology is so improved and so sensitive, special, you know, specific HPLC, we can do that. And here are some examples of, let's look at some of those measurements of ascorbic acid versus reduced glutathione, oxidized glutathione, GSSG, which is oxidized, and GSH, which is reduced glutathione. If you look at healthy individuals versus breast cancer, you see there is significant difference, especially if you take and divide reduced glutathione to oxidized glutathione, the ratio is 1.45 in healthy individuals. In cancer patients, it's 0.4. So meaning they have more oxidized glutathione than reduced. And ascorbic acid also, you see, they have much less. And this is intracellular. See the same thing. Meaning healthy individuals, they have more reduced glutathione versus oxidized. Cancer patients, they have more oxidized than reduced glutathione. So the ratio reverses itself. And this is the method of, you know, HPLC. You can see example of some cancer patients that they don't have some of those peaks. You see with the red arrows?
What's on the scales of this? What are you looking at?
This is exactly what we get from HPLC.
I mean, what are these three? Okay. What are they measuring? What's on the horizontal axis?
Time.
This is time.
Yeah.
And this is concentration. The larger the peak, the more concentration.
What does time have to do with?
Because the way that HPLC works, for each analyte, when any chemicals get dissolved in it, it comes at a certain period out. Like, for example, ascorbic acid is about 3.5 minutes, okay? And reduced glutathione is about 6 minutes, and then oxidized glutathione is somewhere around 13, 14 even, a little bit later. So that's how you have your controls, and you run with that, and then you calculate them out.
So three different ones?
Yes.
Why are the three different runs? Why are they showing three different patients?
In this case, no. These are, I don't know, different chemicals coming out. But in here, really, the upper one is the real. Okay. So then with the alpha tocopherol, gamma tocopherol, lycopene, alpha carotene, beta carotene, coQ10, also we measure in plasma. And again, look at some of these numbers. Cancer patients, they have much lower levels of fat-soluble vitamins in the plasma. And the next one is in the cells, in white blood cells. In particular, look at lycopene, 109 versus 38. Alpha-carotene, 16 versus 6, beta-carotene, 73 versus 28, and CoQ10, 192 versus 67. Okay. So here really are four different patients. And some of them, you see these peaks are completely missing right here, for example. And that's, these are cancer patients. I don't know if you are familiar with the Livingston Foundation in San Diego.
Yes.
They send all their immunology tests to us, and it's more than 5 years I have done so many of them. And sometimes you find nothing in the plasma or in the cells. Okay, now, can we, by using diet, prevent cancer? I think in the beginning that, you know, I gave that message that about 50 to 75% of cancers are preventable if we use correct diet. And actually the new name is chemo prevention. And they say chemo prevention should start as early as possible at the base of the cancer volcano. You remember the volcano? And not to wait until the cancer is fully developed. And the definition is an attempt to use natural and synthetic compounds to intervene at the early precancerous stages of carcinogenesis before invasive disease begins. And again, it emphasizes that it must focus the beginning in the childhood and not to wait, you know, when it's too late. Now, genetic predisposition, and I'm going to show you again those percentages that, you know, that you can read them. If you remember that we said lifestyle, 33 to 40%, and those are the type of cancers. Smoking, drinking, 33 to 40%. Sunlight, 1 to 2%. Diet related, 30 to 35%. Stomach cancer, 2 to 3%. And again, you see that due to canned food and pickled foods and so forth. Occupational exposure, 5 to 7%. Infections such as H. pylori, Salmonella, and HPV, papillomavirus, 2 to 3%. And more, 2 to 5%, chlamydia, hepatitis, HGLV, HPV. So the infectious agents are about 4 to 8%. That's a lot also. So altogether, if you look at, again, genetics, and that article, I have two copies, it's right there, and I'll give it to Mike if you'd like to have it, you know, make a copy for everybody, you are more than welcome. So you should read that. Now, how can we modify cancer risk factors? And I believe, you know, this group, you are very familiar with this. I would like to go a little bit faster in here and to my study with vitamin C.
Yes, please.
Okay? Okay, in about 1990-91, I really became very interested in vitamin C after meeting with Linus Pauling. In fact, in one of the meetings, he gave a lecture. At the time, he was 92, 93, very alert, and he gave excellent lecture. So, looking at most of his claims, publications, books, and so forth, I didn't see a single article which was done scientifically and published in scientific journal in relation to vitamin C and natural killer cells, which are, as I said, they were the cells fighting cancer in our system. And my claim was, if really Linus Pauling is right, how come he did not show that vitamin C enhanced natural killer cell activity, therefore prevented cancer? And that was the missing link. So, in this experiment, which was, you can see the article is published in Journal of Nutrition Research. Again, I have one copy of each in here. That we took between, I believe, 24 individuals, athletes, on Sunday morning. And we took their first blood and urine. Then we gave them 60 milligrams per kilogram body weight ultra potency made by Metagenics, which is the ascorbate, magnesium ascorbate, potassium ascorbate, sodium ascorbate, ascorbate. It's buffered vitamin C.
And
60 milligram per kilogram body weight. It's you know, for a person like me, about 3-4 grams.
How often?
That one time.
One time.
Just one time. Just so we started at 8 o'clock. We took the blood at 9 o'clock. First, we took blood and urine. We gave them the vitamin. Every 4 hours, we collected again blood and urine. Up to 48 hours. Was an easy project, was very, you know, difficult project. And we had to run more than 500 natural killer selectivity, which, you know, with that procedure I was explaining, you know, separating and all of that. The results of this study was, first of all, we measured absorption of the vitamins intracellular. That's why we were measuring also clearance in the urine. From 4 hours and, okay. If I'll draw for you a kind of picture here like this, that the curve was like this. If we gave the vitamin at this stage and NK cell activity was here, after 2 hours, a little bit decline in NK cell activity. A little bit decline. And then started going up this way. So a little bit decline because of acidity, I believe. That's how I explained that in my article. Now, at 8 hours, we could see enhancement of natural killer cell activity. At 8 hours. At 16 hours, we went more higher. At 24 hours, started going down. At 48 hours, it was like you didn't take anything. Back to the same level we was before. So if a person had NK cell activity of 10, let's take example. NK cell activity of 10, after 2 hours went down to 6. After 8 hours went up to 20. At 16 hours went up to 60. At 24 hours was around 40. And at 48 hours again was to back to 20. So that kind of curve I'm talking about. So what we learned from this, first of all, we have to take vitamins every day at least. Yeah. Every other day or every day, because you know, if you want to have sustained NK cell activities to be stable, you need to take it every day. That was the conclusion of
it. You don't know what would happen if you gave it 4 days in a row and you kept testing it for 6 days.
You maintained it, yeah, that's a different study, yes.
You did that study too.
Yes. You maintained that high.
Now, the example that you gave, is the percentage increase similar to what you find in your...
The percentage, thank you so much. The percentage, in fact, right here, did not change at all. Do not expect natural killer cell number to change in 24 hours. The NK cell number did not move. It was within 10% plus minus 10%, which is laboratory, you know, error in flow cytometry.
So this is all activity?
Activity. Absolutely activity.
And do you know what do you recall what the percentage increase in activity was at those periods of time?
What was the percentage?
The percentage increase in activity at...
It was significantly higher. In 80% of the patients, if they had, for example, activity of 20, they went up to 80, 200, 120, sometimes tenfold increase in significant, very significant enhancement of natural killer cell activity. Okay, now. Then we looked at absorption, okay, because we took the cells. Also, we wanted to see how much they absorb, also in the urine. First of all, 90% of that was detected in the urine. That's you know. So when they tell you your urine becomes expensive, believe them. So, but really what we need only 5 to 10% to improve functionality. If the cells absorb between 5 to 10% of that ascorbic acid, it's enough to improve NK cell activity. You don't need more than that. So that's the first article. Then in the second article, they were interested to compare ascorbic acid versus buffered vitamin C. And especially in relation to that decline and increase in NK cell activity. So this one, again, another 40 patients who took the vitamins, and then we collected blood and urine, and then we did almost the same. The results of this study also published in, let's see, one more, I'll come back to that. Yeah, it's Journal of Nutritional Environmental Medicine that there was significant difference between the buffered vitamin C versus ascorbic acid. And if we read right here, at maximal point, the uptake of ultra potency was higher by 18 to 25%. The uptake intracellular, because buffered vitamin C probably not absorbed much better. But that's overall, for enhancement of natural killer cell activity, pure ascorbic acid almost did the same as buffered vitamin C, overall.
Did you see some people for whom the acidic form was better and others for whom the buffered form was better, or was it always?
No. No, I did not see that. You know, as far as NK cell activity, it's almost similar pattern. Maybe slightly the buffered vitamin C was better, but in both groups, there were some individuals, no matter how much vitamin C you gave them, their NK cell activity did not move a bit. And that's a subgroup. They lack some kind of cytokines, some kind of enzymes, something that really we don't know yet why vitamin C is not helping that subgroup of 10% to 20%. That definitely should be studied further. So that's the second study. And that was in 1997. Then in 1997 also, Dr. Heuser, which some of you may know, some of you heard his name. Anyway, he's very active in the field of immunotoxicology. He sees patients in the Los Angeles area dealing with toxic chemicals, now toxic mold. And he really came to me one day. He said, I would like to give buffered C to my patients who have problems with toxic chemicals. And can you just give me the powder and then you give me 3 grams, 4 grams, and 5 grams. And blindly, he was giving it to his patients, and they were drawing blood before and 24 hours after giving them the vitamins and sending us the samples. So we're doing the NK cell activity. About 8 months later, he came back, he said, now I did probably 40 or 50 patients. Let's sit down and analyze the data. And when we analyze the data, not only NK cell number in this case did not change at all. Again, the numbers did not change. The activity changed significantly, but that wasn't limited to NK cell activity. The function of T cell and the function of B cell also was enhanced, because these are sick population. Remember, the other two studies are healthy individuals almost. Now we are talking about a sick population exposed to toxic chemicals. They have low NK cell activity, low T cell function, low B cell function. He gave them the vitamins and we tested before and after. Again, in 80% of the cases, We got high NK cell activity, high T cell function, high B cell function. Now, whether or not the symptoms of the patients improve, the answer is no. Okay, so in fact, when I was writing the article, that, you know, that's in the discussion of the article, saying that although the symptomatology of the patients did not improve, I believe that we are protecting these patients against future cancer. Because if patients are exposed to toxic chemicals, they have low NK activity, low T cell function, low B cell function, by giving them a vitamin which you enhance all those functionalities, not only you prevent infection in their, you know, in their body, also you prevent cancer, future cancer. That was the discussion of the article.
You said you gave three different doses blindly?
He decided based on, again, 60 milligram per kilogram, not blindly.
Oh, okay.
He knew that, you know, he said that his patients mainly fell into that category. Now, finally, the last one is this one in cancer detection and prevention. Let's just read. This study was designed to examine the effects of 500 to 5,000 milligram of ascorbic acid on DNA adduct, natural killer cell activity, apoptosis, and cell cycle. Why I did this study? Because after having those three publications, and suddenly you see it in the news everywhere saying that vitamin C is causing cancer. Okay? And when I went to UCLA library and I found that article, it was one page in Nature by a British group who measured DNA ADA, 8-hydroxyguanosine, also 8-oxoadenine. They found 8-hydroxyguanosine was reduced. That's DNA ADA. But 8-oxoadenine was enhanced. So one of them was reduced, the other one enhanced. Together, they never, you know, they did not pay attention to the one which was decreased. They only talked about the one which was increased, and the media picked it up and went, you know, they ran with it, saying that vitamin C is causing cancer.
DNA.
What? No, but no, in the media they said it's causing cancer.
Really?
I saw a story.
DNA damage.
Well, DNA damage is cancer.
You gotta read it. The worst.
It was something you know, like that. So, well, I said, you know, I have already three studies. If vitamin C improves functionality, how can cause DNA damage? How can really cause cancer? So, I had to go back again. Because I never measured the dosage of 500, 1,000, 3,000, and 5,000. So that we designed this study, 5 in each group. You know, again, healthy individuals, including myself, and I was among the 5,000. Okay, to show that really, you know, vitamin C is not harmful. You know, is not causing any harm. I was in the 5,000 group. So right. Then again, we took blood before and after, and we did all these studies. So in this case, we measured DNA adduct, okay? 8-hydroxyguanosine. In my laboratory, we didn't have capability of measuring 8-oxoadenine like the other group. We measured just one. But we did NK cell activity. NK cell activity went high. Apoptosis went down, meaning the cells in the body became healthier. They stayed in the body, you know, much longer. So apoptosis was down. Then cell cycle, there are 4 phases in the cell cycle. The healthy, which is G0, G1, then S phase, and then G2M. We switch cells from unhealthy phase to healthy phase. So based on that, we concluded that ascorbic acid is an antioxidant, and doses up to 5,000 milligram do not induce mutagenic lesions. The 8-hydroxyguanosine is a measure of mutagenic lesions, nor have negative effects on NK cell activity, apoptosis, or on cell cycle. That was the conclusion of the article. Then the group wrote a letter to the editor, and I had to rebuttal the letter. What they claimed, first of all, that the numbers were few in my study, which I may agree with them. You know, you cannot take 1,000 people and do the same studies. And then the next one, they say it was only for 2 weeks. Their study was a little bit longer. And I suggested that their conclusion should have been that ascorbic acid is a net antioxidant. Why? Because if 8-hydroxyguanosine was lower, 8-oxoadenine was higher, but this one 5 times in the body more than this one, the net amount is in the favor of 8-hydroxyguanosine, which was lower than oxoadenine. Even their study was showing that overall, the net effect should have been vitamin C is antioxidant, not claiming vitamin C is an oxidant. Okay, so it is important to note from this study that upon supplementation with ascorbic acid, intracellular are found to increase in some of the healthy volunteers, supporting our comments in Nature. It has been suggested previously that leukocytes in all healthy individuals are saturated prior to supplementation, which I disagreed, but clearly this may not always be the case. So they agreed with me that in some cases the 20% increase in absorption of vitamin C shows that white blood cells, they are not saturated. Now, in my reply, just I'm reading the last part for you, really, that was the most important, that saying that finally we did not create a public uproar over our study, and the media was discreet in raising public awareness regarding the positive benefits of vitamin C usage. Not to mention the rave humor about high-priced bladder byproducts. As researchers, we have responsibility to inform our society whether or not to supplement their diet with vitamin C. Based on our findings and the improvement in immune function assays, I do recommend between 500 to 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C per day. I take 1,000 milligram buffered vitamin C per day, and the next few words were, how about you? That's really Israeli. So then I think the group finally published, I believe, another article, and now they agree almost with us that really vitamin C, in fact, now they're talking about increasing antioxidant enzymes or DNA repair enzymes. That's their new studies, right? You have a copy of that?
I just wanted to ask you if the issue of the oxidized nucleotides as being balanced by repair mechanisms, and really when you see something come out in the urine, that's a mutation that's been corrected, so it's no longer a mutation. So really what you'd want to do is look at how many mutations are not corrected to really know whether this is dangerous or safe.
The DNA adduct in the white blood cells. The DNA adduct we measured is in white blood cells, not in the urine.
Oh, in the cells. Okay.
In the cells.
Okay.
That's why I disagree with measurements of DNA adduct in the urine. You're absolutely right. That depends how your DNA repair enzymes are working. What if your DNA repair enzymes do not work? You will not detect some of that in the urine.
Absolutely. Did anybody discuss the presence of AT pairs at iron binding sites in the DNA?
No,
as a source for
no.
The vitamin C?
But now they're really in their studies. I don't have a copy that we should get a copy of that. They're talking about vitamin C is improving DNA repair enzymes. So that's indirectly actually they're agreeing with us. So this is a a panel of tests we do perform for measuring water-soluble and fat-soluble antioxidants in plasma as well as in white blood cells. So again, requirement for that is a yellow top two, where we separate the plasma from that and also white blood cells.
How much is that test?
A neighborhood of $400, something like that. Now, this is a long panel of, you have right here, you can pick up some of these, that you look at cellular DNA adduct, protein adducts, again, similar to DNA proteins, chemicals can bind to them, DNA repair enzymes, lipid peroxidation, then all those water-soluble and fat-soluble vitamins are in there, NK cell activity, apoptosis, cell cycle, heat shock proteins, because cancer cells express heat shock proteins and the body attacks them. And therefore we can detect that. Tumor suppressor genes, and there finally oncoproteins such as HER2 in breast cancer. This mixture, all these tests together, about $900 to $1,000. But simple evaluation of the immune system, which you look at T cell, B cell helper, suppressor, NK cell activity, lymphocyte immune function, T cell function, B cell function, IL-2 production, $325. But if you want just really one test to continue a follow-up, to follow up cancer patients after chemotherapy, before chemotherapy, after chemotherapy, and during chemotherapy, the NK cell activity is the gold standard to see how your patient is doing. If you want to be more thorough, then you add, you know, this, we call it triple immune function test, where NK cell activity, apoptosis, and cell cycle of the white blood cells are measured simultaneously. When you have three tests together, each one of these separately is $150. In a panel, it's only $225. We do a lot of these panels for many clinicians who are familiar with this type of testing. And that's the crew in the laboratory helping me. Now, I have with me some literature in here I would like to tell you a little bit about, so you will pick up some of this if you like. First of all, I will leave the articles with Mike, that is, if you would like to have a copy, you are more than welcome. Then I have a brochure here about prostate cancer. On the back, we have prostate health panel. For many years, we do PSA, free PSA, IGF-1, IGF binding protein, and lycopene, because you are looking at, not when PSA is high, first of all, what percentage is free PSA? Then you look at growth factors. We want low IGF, high IGF binding protein, and we want high lycopene. So I have those brochures over there, please, if you would like to pick up them. Then this one about cancer. Okay, I want every one of you to take one of these, please. Three articles written about the role of infectious agents in cardiovascular disease and autoimmunity by me in a journal called Laboratory Medicine. And with this cover, and I had the reason to put this cover together because my mother was suffering from arthritis, osteoarthritis, for 40 years. She passed away 3 months ago, but before that, you know, I discovered actually how she got the disease when she had, you know, oral infection, and they were removing her teeth when she had infection ongoing in her body. So that story is here also.
Was she cured of it by fixing the dental situation?
No. What happened that back then, I'm talking about 40, 45 years ago, she had infection in the mouth and they were removing three teeth while she had the infection going on. The toxins from the bacteria, as a microbiologist, okay, I'm talking now, the toxins enter into the system, and when you react to these toxins, the antibodies against that, the immune complex and everything, turn against your tissue. The results of that after many years is arthritis and autoimmune disease. So I have this booklet. I have a few of these. If you want more, please ask Mike. I'll send him more. So that's the next. And then I do a lot of research in the field of neuroimmunology, because now that's, I work in the Department of Neurobiology at UCLA with my colleagues, so I got involved in the field of autism mainly and multiple sclerosis. Okay, so here you have a booklet about autism, mechanism of action, with a couple hundred references. I have about 10 or 12 of these. And finally, Mike asked me to bring with me a reprint of an article which is going to be published any day in Journal of Internal Medicine, how to do laboratory diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. Okay, I have 10 copies with me. This is one of them, the rest are sitting right there. Please pick up these. And the idea is the following, that you know that MS is diagnosed mainly based on clinical findings, MRI. But MRI, I will show you in some of other presentations, including in autism, that patients who have gluten ataxia, gluten sensitivity, they have exactly similar MRI as MS patient. The third kind
of alternative therapies for people with degenerative conditions and pain.
Is it?
Yeah, I'm Ladislav Pataki. I'm escaped from Czechoslovakia a long time ago. Yeah. And I used to be a research scientist, hardcore. Then I lost my focus in that and come here and did all kind of stuff. Now I have a company which does make health food products. I make health food products. And then I have some mail order company on the side to sell some. But yeah. Otherwise, I just host it.
Taki, please tell a little bit about your athletic background also.
Yeah, I owned many world records in track and field. I own a high strength world record in masters track and field. If you take a look at the points, how much I get, I get 5,500 points. Second best world record is 4,900. So I did pretty well. I enjoy doing sports.
Is that over 55? Is that masters?
From age 50, I improved every year until 57. Right now, this course I'm throwing further than age 50. I'm throwing over 180 feet, many times, three, four times in a workout. And in the wind, I threw 200 feet. I can beat the world record in that also. As long as I make a mark, that is a good advice if you like. Make a mark and just work for it, you know, for a while. It happens or not, so. I like to do it. I'm not phony, okay, so. Proof is in pudding, that's all I say.
A guy who's been reading books like Dr. Levy's book and thinking about stuff. I have some stuff I want to talk about Mega C, if we have time.
Let's come back. We can definitely do that. That's important. Okay, let's stay in the middle section, and then we'll go to the last section. Yeah.
Tim Gallagher, I'm the treasurer of the organization, and send your money in.
Okay, well, what else? He's also a world-class dentist, and yes. Most of us have been there to get, you know, help, especially if you want to have your mercury moved and not healed in the process. That's the guy to go to. Dan.
The key words are world class.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I'm Stan Field, chemical engineer. When I was hiking in Yosemite, I met Emil Zatopek.
Oh,
yeah. He's probably the world's greatest runner from Czechoslovakia.
Yeah, I remember. How old is he now?
I think he's gone now.
He was setting records.
Yeah, this was, I met him in 1987 in Yosemite. Mm-hmm. And we were just three of us, Judy, myself, and Emil Zatopek.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. In 1950, he told me in 1952 that he won the 5,000 meter the 10,000 meter, and then he ran just for kicks in the marathon and won that. Nobody's ever done it.
Maybe. How about Ladislav?
story about
different events. He's a weight man. He's a
story about his running is that he afraid to drink or even take a lemon or anything because he never had experience with it. Right? Yeah. So he ran that marathon without a drink.
Without a drink.
And just he's my very good friend. Okay, he used to after they threw him out from army. He was in a library in Prague, and I'd spend a lot of time with him always.
Oh, okay.
He always showed me how to drink a beer, make sure that the bubbles don't escape, you know. So
I have to tell you, in Yosemite, I had carried a backpack, everything there to get there, and then I was doing a day hike. So I'm coming down from Cloud's Rest, and there's this guy coming down with just a stick, and a water bottle, and a green hat with a feather in it. That's all he was carrying. And so we converged down the bottom, and that's when I met him. And he had walked in from somewhere, I don't know where, but he didn't have anything, wasn't carrying anything.
Amazing.
He invented the interval training, if you would like to. Interval training.
Interval training.
His best, greatest workout was 100 times 400 meters.
Wow. Now on the website, thanks to Ryan and Stan working on this. So if you want to get a hold of some of his stuff, and for example, his analysis of testosterone and what the proper protocol is, go to the website, you'll find it there. Isn't that right, Stan?
No.
No?
It's we're redoing the website.
Oh, really?
It requires coordination between Albuquerque, Cupertino, and Pacifica. So it's going to take a little time, but we're going to have eventually all of those reports.
Yeah.
What's
up there right now, Ryan? What is the software?
They typed in the curse of the software.
Okay, that's a good
it's
one.
Not a, wasn't scanned
so
in.
So the testosterone stuff not there yet. Okay. Yes, sir.
I'm Jess Kanarek, and my interest in nutrition started in 1932 with Alfred W. McCann, went through Victor Lindlar, Carlton Fredericks. I was one of the first guys on an Atkins diet, so I've been studying nutrition for 70 years.
Wow.
70 years.
Well, now, tell us, how old are you now?
79.
That's outstanding. Yes, sir.
My name's Martin. I live in Palo Alto, and the only thing about me is that I don't own a car, and I bike around.
Like to run?
Bike around. Bike.
Bicycle.
Oh, bike. Mm-hmm.
I used to be one.
Thank you for being here. Okay, Lita.
I have no particular qualifications. I just, my name is Lita Decker, and I just am so interested in all this. So,
speak to me. Is it the school at Smith in Kansas, was it, Utah?
No, here. Both.
Oh, yeah, okay,
both,
right.
Actually. And Germany.
My name is Dee Grief. I am an LOL, and I do as little as possible.
Anybody know what LOL is? What are we doing? Just standing up and saying who you are. And what's your how you got interested in health?
You can say a name with hell if you want.
Well, I'm Frank Anderson, and I've been interested in alternative medicine since the 1970s, and I'm trying to learn more all the time.
Yeah, thanks, Nick. Okay, good. I think we got your name on the mailing list, too.
I hope so.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm George Butler. My first time here. I know nothing about this stuff, but I'm interested in prostate cancer therapies.
Okay, good. Well, the man who knows is a prostate cancer in-house expert is Mike Cork. And so you should talk to him afterwards. He's a wealth of information. What he does know, he knows people who know it.
Very good.
So let's go over here. This is Carter. Why don't you stay seated? Why don't you
I'm Myra Karp. My main interest in this is in the 120-year diet, so-called, proposed by the UCLA Medical School. I run a nominal 20 miles a week, I run 10K races. I'm 75. I'm looking for ways of lasting till 100 or maybe 120. That's about it. Lane New Carp got degrees, PhD in education, and a degree in teaching of English to speakers of other languages, and another master's degree in communication. She taught for many years. She taught the Bible. She taught religious studies at one college. She taught. She was a technical writer in the 80s in the New York area, and now she's retired. And that's it.
And by the way, Ira and Lena have a daughter who is a rabbi in Boston. So I think that's also good.
Yeah.
One other thing. Ira has the unique distinction of having HDL of 120, and no doctor here has ever seen it, a number like that.
Jeez.
Wow. I had it once. Well,
it doesn't happen by accident. If you get out and run your 20 miles a week, and you also push away the table. Right now I'm trying to implement a fasting twice a week. And today is one of the fast days. The point is that it's a matter of getting your calorie count to something like 12 or 1300 calories a day on average for a week. And it's a tough haul.
Let me ask you, what's your total cholesterol?
It's about 160 or so.
Really? That's all?
Well, that's it. It's very. It used to be 150, and it's begun to climb.
In other words, your LDL is only 40 or 50.
My LDL is there's something funny about the cholesterol. The total of the HDL and the LDL don't add up to the total. There's some other fudge factor in there.
HDL needs to be divided by 5.
But the point is that that if you eat a near vegetarian diet and you keep the total calories down to something that resembles 12, 13, 1400 calories, and you get out and run your 20 miles a week.
Nutrition since my first year in college, and was actually ran across Dirk Pearson and Sandy Shaw way back before they were became famous. I was actually the first speaker for this group too when Catherine Gross set it up, and there were 6 people there, so this is a much better showing. I guess I'm kind of a ad hoc advisor to the group.
Ad hoc, Steve has been our main man for the beginning, really. It's just biochemist. He had a marvelous newsletter, which was kind of displaced by the rise of the internet. Before you could get everything with a click of the mouse, he had probably the best newsletter going, and supported himself that way. But technology changes everything. So now he's inventing all kinds of stuff. But he's still our main man. We just have a hard time getting him here, so very happy to see you. Shirley.
Hey, I'm Shirley Potez, and I have a master's degree in education, and I'm a certified nutritional consultant. And I started back 45 years ago with Dr. N.W. Walker, raw foodist, and then I've been involved with the National Health Federation for all these years.
As president, right?
Yes, and then I put on local meetings every month for 13 years in complementary medicine with different doctors. And now I wasn't able to come to this meeting until just this past year, which I'm a member. And so, I started teaching on TV of raw foods. That was 40 years ago, too. Wow. And Jack LaLanne used to come on as exercise person before he started his show.
And,
right. And I prepared the food and talked about the nutrition. And so I'm into a lot of raw foods and put on seminars with as a certified instructor from Hippocrates in Florida. So I really enjoy coming here with all the health professionals and what you're doing in this group. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name is Bill Anderson, and I'm just interested in vitamin C and all that.
Great. By the way, I did remember to bring books this time. If anybody hasn't got Levy's book yet, I've got copies for $20. It's a hardcover. I think it costs $30 if you get it through Jen's. I also have the paper 10, and I have about 2-3 copies of that, and I think Jim has some, Jim Carstein has some. So, yes, sir.
And the video's on the web.
Yeah. Yes.
Joe Anderson, he's had the key here, and so I'm here.
Great, welcome. Okay, Ryan.
I'm Ryan Joss, I'm the manager of Smile Life Forum.
Yeah, a little louder, Ryan, you're way back there.
Okay, I've been interested in health probably since I read Linus Pauling's book, my dad provided probably about 10 years ago.
Where'd your dad get to? He's
right.
There he is, okay, right. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Dan, this is my first time here, and I'm persuaded by Ryan to come learn about vitamin C.
Okay, great. Yeah.
What's the question?
What's the question? Right.
Who are you?
We're going around for a chance so everybody can find out who's here for a change.
Yeah.
So if you came in late, so I'm fine on you guys.
Okay. I'm Tim Joslin. I've been coming to meetings, I don't know, maybe 7-8 years. I just like to be a sponge and pick up a lot of things that I get, maybe try to apply it to my own life.
Great. Okay, great. And to Tim's like good offices, we have the services of Ryan. So that's a great thing too.
Oh, satisfactory degree. So you get lead, mercury, with your vitamin C. Now that may be okay if you're taking 60 milligrams.
60 grams.
Right, you're taking 60 grams.
Oh, yeah.
The heavy metals add up to a lot.
Well, the C is going to chelate the lead anyway. So
why do you use a magnesium instead of, let's say, sea salt?
I just feel odd about taking 100 grams of acid, you know.
How about the sea salt?
The sea salt has got calcium in it, and according to Levy, we shouldn't be taking calcium, so I just stick with magnesium ascorbate.
Okay, I'll tell you what, Dr. Rajdhani has done a lot of work with vitamin C, and he would like to comment on this too, so why don't we...
Introduce the two doctors that came in.
Dr. Carl Ebnath is one of them. Oh yeah, and Tim
Guilford,
right? And Tim. Okay, Dr. Johnny, just comment on this, and then we'll introduce him properly in a minute.
Every time they talk about vitamin C, you know, the main stream of medicine, they pick up one single article, which is published about kidney stone. And really, in your case, one should analyze your urine to see what are you excreting in the urine. Are you forming some crystals in the urine? Or, you know, it's very, you know, fascinating to do that, you know, to look at your urine before and after. What's happening? You know, it's because that's a reflection of the kidney function. So for, you know.
Who wants to do it?
and
that's a very easy test. Any laboratory can do it for you.
What about cellular level?
And definitely, that's the other issue is really how much of this your cells are absorbing, and you'll hear from me that really not much. And as far as cellular absorption, there is a limit that your cells can absorb vitamin C after that plateaus.
Okay.
I'm talking about functional level.
But my symptoms go away only if I go above about 80 or 90 a day.
Carol.
Well, I've been dumping huge amounts of vitamin C into people since 1970, and I've never seen somebody get a urinary stone from it. I've taken up to 118,000 myself. That's 118 grams, and I haven't come close to kidneys. I think that's a greatly exaggerated concern.
Okay. Well, one thing that might be worth thinking about is that I think that consumption of vitamin C increases the body's use of copper, and maybe you might want to also add some copper supplementation. Is that true, Steve?
I don't know. I know that there's a lot of confusion about copper because people have looked at storage proteins for copper, ceruloplasmin, and have inferred that there's some connection between that and cellular copper levels, and there isn't. And so you really need to look at the cellular level and look at the, for example, the enzyme activity of superoxide dismutase to really get an idea of what the copper status is, or some other, you know, cellular assay.
Dr. Cunyon, in a great lecture he gave strictly on copper, Richard Cunyon.
Shirley put it on, as a matter of fact. It was the Northern California National Health Federation chapter, and he said he found through his research, or research of others, that per 10,000 milligrams of vitamin C, you need at least 4 to 8 milligrams of copper. But if you take copper, he said you're wasting your money with copper gluconate, because you pee a lot of that away. He said you should stick with copper sabacate, which is bound to glutathione, so you get a better absorption of it. And then I'm sure you probably check your zinc levels to have some kind of a balance. What's the ratio on that again?
Well, there's a sequestration mechanism that takes place with copper. Whenever your immune system is activated, you get a cascade of cytokines that stimulate various cells to engage in a kind of defense mechanism against the infection. And one of those mechanisms is to store copper, because copper can be a growth factor for microorganisms, and zinc and iron especially is a huge growth factor for bacteria. And so this is a defense mechanism. So if you have an immune system reaction that's chronic, that's been going on for years and decades, your copper status in your cells may be seriously depleted, and you might also want to consider transdermal copper. This is something that was discovered by people with arthritis using copper bracelets. Well, the acids in the skin etch the copper, and the copper compounds form fatty acid salts that are absorbed through the skin. And you can also buy something called Arthrelief, which is sold at Wholesale Nutrition down in Saratoga. And it's just a copper cream. It's blue. You rub it on your skin, and the color disappears. The copper soaks in. And that form of copper bypasses the sequestration mechanism. So it doesn't go through the liver. It gets stashed into ceruloplasmin. It becomes available through, you know, delivery through lipid systems, and so people usually experience a much greater degree of relief if their symptoms are related to a copper deficiency.
Dr. Cunningham would say the average copper bracelet, you'll absorb about 13 milligrams.
Thanks, Dave. 13 milligrams of copper per month. And so that's why it's a good insurance policy to just wear one. And people I know the technology of this go, why not? You know, oops, where's mine? Oh.
By the way, you know, copper is a tough problem, because copper, along with iron and zinc, are pro-oxidants. So you can get too much. So, you know, again, the question of balance, and what's the right balance? Don't ask me, because, you know, it's too complicated for me to get it. Really,
there are psychiatric symptoms associated with copper excess.
Yeah,
but there might be others. There might be other problems.
Copper. There's argument that it was a copper deficiency that was associated with the psychiatric.
Wow. Yeah, see, it's a very complex thing. By the way, we have to get on to our main event here, but I wanted to do one more thing before we do that, and that takes me to a restatement of our policy. Now, this is a forum. We don't, as a group, endorse anything. We don't endorse even healthy food and good exercise. I mean, we don't do anything as a group. Each member, including myself, has opinions and information to share, and we share it. And because I want to bring up something now that I don't understand, but I think is very important and very striking, and I think it's something that's so noteworthy that we should talk about it, even though at this point I have only the foggiest idea what's involved, and even if the thing is legitimate. And that what I want to talk about is the experience of one of our members.
I'm back in Kansas, and his wife is about 59 years old. I've known them both for many years. She's a beautiful, really beautiful young lady at that age. Alzheimer's, she can no longer read, no longer write. I called him, I told him about this. I had him call Catherine Alexander, and she said, my God, this is, you know, it's really quite amazing. The same thing that Mike had. Mike got George to go down to the Dominican Republic, and basically, he immediately called Dr. Rader, got on the phone, spent about 20 minutes with him, called back, sent him the money, and said, hey, listen, I'm going to spend the $25,000. He said, that's 6 or 7 months in a nursing home. And he said, that nursing home goes on for the rest of the life. He says, I've lost more money going in and out of bars than that. And he said, so if it works, it works. And if it doesn't, you know, who cares? And I think it's an important thing. So what Steve is saying and what Mike is saying Mike, I think you had it done, Mike, didn't you? He needed it because he had a personality problem. And, physically, he's okay, but we all know that he comes a little up a little
listen,
short.
Listen, I'll tell you something. You don't know. He was worse when he was young.
Yeah.
That's Don told me this, and that's what prompted me to bring up the whole matter, because it's so amazing. So as I say, I don't know what to make of it, but this is the group we are, right? We're a pioneering group. We're trying to understand these things. So let's all put our radar out there and see what comes up.
Jasmine. And I'll just make it short by reading what was in here in case you haven't come across it.